Hello, everyone, and thank you for joining us for today's panel discussion on quantum perspectives in simulation. I'm John Donahue, the Senior Manager of Scientific Outreach at the Institute for Quantum Computing. The IQC is a multidisciplinary research institute at the University of Waterloo, studying the potential and development of quantum information science. Quantum information science is a field that brings together researchers from science, engineering, mathematics, and computer science to develop new kinds of sensors, communication strategies, computing paradigms, and materials. Throughout the quantum perspective series, we have learned about research being done in Canada that supports these pillars of the field. Now, throughout the event, please feel free to ask any questions in the chat box, and we'll get to as many as possible before wrapping up. Before we get started, a few brief announcements. There is 1 month left to apply for the undergraduate school on experimental quantum information processing. USQIP is a two-week summer school hosted at the University of Waterloo, where you'll learn from experts in quantum information research and get hands-on experience with lab equipment. If you are currently in an undergraduate program, please consider applying before January 3rd. You can apply for summer research terms with IQC researchers on your application. Additionally, we've also just launched the application for the Quantum School for Young Students, QSIS. This is a two-week program, and it's a fantastic introduction to the world of quantum information for students in grade 11 and 12 of high school. If you're interested, find out more information on our website and apply by March 31st. Today, we are discussing quantum simulation. When the first ideas of quantum computing were proposed, no one knew about things like factoring and search algorithms. The initial idea was rather simple in concept. If we want to understand systems that obey the laws of quantum mechanics, we'd need some kind of computing device that also knows the rules of quantum mechanics. And just as these rules are complicated for us to understand, they're difficult for traditional computers to work with as well. But if we had a computer or a computing device that already functioned by the rules of quantum mechanics, perhaps we could use it to simulate the behavior of other quantum systems as well. Such a quantum simulator could find applications in discovering exotic materials, understanding foundational physics and chemistry, and more. Now, simple in concept does not mean simple in execution, however. Converting problems of interest into recipes that can be implemented on real lab equipment is one of the most active subfields of quantum information. Today, we have experts in theoretical and experimental quantum simulation with us. Each will have 10 minutes to talk about their research and insights on quantum simulation, and we'll bring everyone back for an open Q&A afterwards. Once again, do please feel free to ask any questions you have in the chat, and we'll relay them to the panelists. Firstly, it's my pleasure to introduce Professor Na-Young Kim. Professor Kim is an associate professor at the Institute for Quantum Computing and the Department of Electrical and Computer Engineering at the University of Waterloo, where she leads the Quantum Innovation Laboratory studying exotic materials and nanodevices. Before joining UWaterloo, she earned her PhD and completed postdoctoral work at Stanford University, and then worked for Apple Inc. on miniature display products. Professor Kim, thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you, John, for this wonderful opportunity, and also sharing some of the work in particular in the quantum simulators. So as John introduced what the quantum simulator is, it's a designated hardware which solves a specific class of problems. That's what I define these quantum simulators. And sometimes even I call it as the more designated analog quantum simulators. In particular, we are building the quantum simulator based on the solid state materials. And here I'd like to introduce the two streams of it. One is a block exciton polaritons, and the other is a Rydberg excitons. Both system is based on the numerous different semiconductor materials, and then we'd like to engineer the light matter interactions. And I'm also going to describe that the quantum simulators in this case is a Hamiltonian engineering. Okay. So first system is microcavity exciton polaritons. It is the consequence of the semiconductor band gap engineerings as well as a doping. So as you see in the on the left side is that's how we monolithically grow a structure which can confine the light in the semiconductor systems, and where we also assign this the matter and the whose the quantization happens in the excitons. In the next slide, just give you the brief schematics of the materials. So where this the light, the electromagnetic field is confined in the cavity, where this light is absorbed by this the gain media, where it excites the exciton, so that when this light is strongly interacting with this matter quantity exciton, then we have a new quasi-particle, so-called a microcavity exciton pluriton. So it sounds like it's a heavy word, but then you can imagine that there's an entity which has the electron hole pairs and which is addressed by the photon. So because of this combination of photon aspects and exciton, which is charged particle, so that the exciton pluriton has the inherent duality of particle nature and wave nature. Using this, the nature, and we like to manipulate the systems of the exciton pluritons. One nice thing about the exciton pluriton case is that first we have a material advantages of the semiconductor advanced nanofabrication techniques, as well as this atomic thickness control of the growth techniques. So using this so that we have the flexibility to design the materials. And then when we also characterize the systems, that the signals of the exciton pluritons or the dynamics of the exciton pluriton actually comes out as a form of photon, so that if we are able to capture these photons, then we have a quantitative information of lots of physical parameters like energy or momentum and spin degrees of freedoms and so on. So that this is just the small illustration of how to measure the quantities of exciton pluritons. There's a kind of manifestation of this exciton pluriton is so-called like an anti-crossing behavior. It means that you have to separate the energy bands, which is the existence of the strong couple between the exciton and photons. And the next nice property of exciton pluriton is that these quantum particles obey the so-called Bose-Einstein condensation, Bose-Einstein statistics, so that we are able to initialize the system in a macroscopic coherent states. So this gives another knob to create the quantum simulators. So as the John describes that the quantum simulator mimics certain problems. In this case, I'm going to show just examples of how we can understand the material. And for example, like exotic materials like the high temperature superconductors and so on. We like to understand the microscopic understanding of such exotic materials so that we have a room to improve the properties. When we consider the materials, then often in the real material that we are looking at electrons. So everyone learns that about the electrons and orbitals. So as you see, the s orbitals, p orbitals, and so on. So that inside of the atom, how does the electrons are reside with what kind of orbital degrees of freedom? So that these are the basis for explain about their physical properties. Once this individual atom forms as a crystal structure, here is the examples of the honeycomb lattice, which is the graphene structure, or the square lattice is actually examples of the cuprous oxide in the high temperature superconductor. So that by understanding of the orbital of the atoms and also the hybridization of the orbitals between the different the elements, so that we like to understand what the exotic properties come from. And this typical solid state materials or the condensed matter physics, the way to characterize these electrons in a crystal structure is by looking at the behavior of the energy as a function of momentum, or so-called the construction of the bend structure, so that we want to understand how the Fermi level of electrons move or the behave. So that the, this is still used by this angle result of auto-emission spectroscopy to elucidate the relation of the energy and the momentum. Another lens to look at this, the characteristic of the electrons in crystal, is to observe this the density distribution in real space. So as you see on the right image at the bottom is the, so you see some distribution of the square lattice, so that the, this shows how electrons are populated in this the real space coordinates. So this is the way we understand this the real materials. And now in this the quantum simulator cases, we like to prepare our engineered particle, which I described the exciton polaritons. And second, we like to introduce or the launch the artificial lattices, which can trap this exciton polariton, just like mimicking of electrons in the real materials. So that we have, again, this the semiconductor gives us the lots of opportunities to look at the, create this the spatial potentials using the dynamical aspects of piezoelectricity or the etchings, or the even we can apply the electric fields and so on. So that the combination of those the methods to create the artificial lattices. And the last is the how to characterize this. And again, in the form of the photons that we can directly measure this energy and momentum distribution, which is corresponds to the band structure. We are also allowed to look at this, how the particles are distributed in real space. Furthermore, not only the density distribution, we can also have this phase information as well. So that the last slides I'm actually summarizing is that the what kind of Hamiltonian we are like to solve, which is the immediate target of the solistic quantum simulators. I actually give, there's gotta be the lots of different opportunities, not only just the computer science, the physics domains, but people also consider this the astrophysics or this the particle physics, as well as the medical physics or the biologies and so on. In this cases, I just give you the just a quick two showcases so that the quantum simulators can also tackle as the optimization solver in the computer science problem. For example, like a salesman, the traveling salesman problem, which is the known to be the extremely hard problem, but then it could be mapped as a Hamiltonian, as I said, that the quantum simulators can be a Hamiltonian, the engineering system, so that the, if we are able to address this the specific Hamiltonian and find out the solutions, then that actually gives the hints of the real problem. That's how we connect our simulator to the real problem. Another the interesting avenue is to search for the quantum materials or exotic the materials, which often have a strong difficulty of the lots of the entangled factors in the materials. But in the quantum simulator cases, we are able to address some specific the term or specific interaction term, so that the, we have improved our knowledge. So these are the some of the quick overview of the solistic quantum simulators in my group. So thanks for your attention.
Thank you so much, Professor Kim, for sharing your work. Professor Kim, we will invite you back after the next two presentations to participate in the roundtable. But before we get to there, it's my pleasure to introduce our next panelist. Our next panelist is Dr. Jinglai Zhang. Dr. Zhang is a postdoctoral fellow at the Institute for Quantum Computing and the Department of Physics and Astronomy at the University of Waterloo, where she is part of the Quantum Interactions Theory Group led by Professor Christine Mushik. Prior to joining IQC, Dr. Zhang earned her PhD from Aarhus University in the group of Klaus Molnar. Jinglai, thank you so much for joining us today.
Hello. Thank you for inviting me and giving me the opportunity to talk a little bit about my research. I work in the field of quantum simulation for energy physics. This is just going to be a general overview. And yeah, I will welcome any question about any technical details. So what is the fundamental idea of quantum simulation? So usually we have some very complex system that the properties of which we want to study, but we don't have control over it. And then on the other side, we have some other system of which we can have very precise control and measurement. And then the idea is that we use this controllable system to imitate the ones on which we don't have control and to learn some properties about it. In the case of systems that are regulated by quantum mechanics, then it is a very natural thought that a quantum computer, a quantum programmable computer, is what we need to study these systems. And as you said before, any of these universal quantum computers were conceived of, quantum simulators were just this natural way of thinking about usefulness of quantum computers. So now we have we live in a very exciting times, I think, in which people and experimentalists have are developing some very exciting new platforms that show quantum features and on which they have, I think, absolutely amazing amount of control. And I think these systems offer absolutely new opportunities for anyone who wants to study any other type of quantum systems. So I feel like this is right at the frontier of quantum technologies and what we can do right now. As far as quantum systems go, what my research focuses on is quantum simulation for high energy physics or particle physics. And the best model that we have to describe particle physics currently, it's what is called the standard model of elementary particles. It describes the universe and everything we know to its most elementary constituent. And it's just a beautiful and elegant theory that was, I think, one of the most important advances in physics in recent years. However, this theory, although very beautiful, it's also extremely complex. And the analytical results are very, very few and very hard to get. So we need to rely on numerical simulations. And in the 80s, there was this development of the field of lattice QCD, lattice chromodynamics, where people used very rudimentary classical computers to try to do numerical simulations for this model. And since then, we know that the classical computers have developed enormously. Now we have super powerful computers that can do much, much more. And in the same way, the field of classical lattice quantum chromodynamics has been able to do some amazing calculations to incredible precision. And they were able to study properties, very important properties of matter and of matter. However, this classical method, they are intrinsically limited because we know that the theory is quantum. So there are certain settings that are affected by the so-called sign problem. And this just means that in these settings, classical calculations are just absolutely forbidden. And they are like these settings are inaccessible to classical calculations. On the other hand, these settings are also describe a very interesting interesting phenomena that we really want to study. Here I just have a few examples of that. So one example is real-time evolution. The picture I have is the image of a collision at LHC. So anything that is described as some kind of dynamics, some type of time evolution, is inaccessible to classical computations. Another one is topological terms, and these topological terms are important because they are one of the candidates that people consider to describe, for example, to explain and describe the imbalance between matter and antimatter that we observe in our universe. So that is something for which we don't have any explanation so far. And the other one is neutron stars. So neutron stars is just an example where we have a physical system with extremely high density, and when we have this very high density, these classical calculations are absolutely numerically stable and cannot produce any useful results. But you can see that these are all very interesting scientific questions that we have, and that we really want to study. This is where the quantum computers hopefully can help us, because in the Hamiltonian formulation, like just quantum computers are just a more natural way to reformulate this theory. And in principle, there is nothing that forbids them to study and to simulate these very interesting scenarios. Okay, so so my research focuses on questions that are related to particle physics, as I said. And what we like to do in our group is really we ask ourselves how to simulate a high energy physics model with current quantum devices. So we don't do any. So we try to be very concrete and very practical, and we try to take into consideration the limitations of the currently available quantum devices, and we want to use them right now to do some simulations and to learn how to study high energy physics models. So currently, current quantum computers, we know they are mostly quite small. So we know that if we want to have a real quantum simulation, then we need to put a lot of effort into formulating our theory in the most hardware efficient possible way. So it reduces the requirement on the amount of qubits or any other resources that that we need. And we also know that current quantum computers are very noisy. So in our group, we also have we put a lot of effort into studying, figuring out how which are the methods that can help us overcome this noise, and when is this noise important, and how can we reduce it, and and things like that. So here I'm just putting a picture of one specific method that we used, which is called randomized compilation. But right now, error mitigation is very popular because it's some kind of an intermediate step between before getting to the completely fault tolerant quantum computer. So so this is also something that it's very practical and we can already do with currently available quantum computer. And then from the physics side, we really want to focus on studying quantities that are physically meaningful. So we take our high energy physics model. It has to be necessarily quite small, but we really want to learn how to put it on a quantum computer and how can we extract quantities that are going to be interesting for the people who have studied these systems already for decades, right? And so we also collaborate with the people who do classical lattice calculations, because they have the questions that that we really want to answer. So these are just some of the areas that we want to focus. And I just want to give a little bit of perspective about where we are going to. So as I said in the beginning, the end goal, the final goal would be to be able to study on a quantum computer the full standard model. That, of course, it's going to be very far in the future. In the meantime, there are many small steps that we need to take in order to build up to these huge results. So one is to be able to have the full theory. So the first quantum simulations for high energy physics were with very simple gauge groups, symmetry groups, and it was with the U1, which describes quantum electrodynamics. And then in my work, I have extended these results to non-abelian groups. So I have worked on SU2 gauge theories and SU3 gauge theory. And SU3 is very exciting because it's the real gauge group that describes chromodynamics. So we are really getting closer and closer. And then another difficulty is that all this model are the model considered so far are in limited spatial dimensions. So it's on a line in 1+1 dimension or 2, but of course we want to go to 3+1 for the full description of nature. And then on the hardware side, I think it's very exciting because we have this problem and we are very open to any kind of hardware that can help us solve this. So so far we have used we have studied microwave systems and the superconducting qubits and trapped ions, but I feel like now there are many more systems that can offer us other advantages and that can be maybe more suited to our purposes. So for example, there are people who are developing quantum computers that have multi-level systems, so qubits instead of qubits, such as and then they can be realized in photons, in atoms, or quantum computers that instead of using qubits, they just use the fermionic systems naturally. And they have this, and this would be a more natural description of some of the theories that we consider. So just to conclude, I feel like this field is very exciting because it allows for this co-development of theory and experiment, where we have to work within the confines of what the experimentalists offer to us. And then we also push each other and we try to find the best way to bring these two fields together and have some nice scientific results.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Jingli. That was a fantastic overview of your group's work. We will bring you back in a little bit for the group Q&A, but first we have one final panelist introduced. Our final panelist today is Dr. Alexandra Cooper-Roy. Dr. Cooper-Roy is the Senior Technical Lead in Quantum Simulation with the Transformative Quantum Technologies Program at the University of Waterloo, where he leads an experimental team developing atomic quantum simulators. Prior to joining UWaterloo, he earned his PhD at MIT and completed postdoctoral research at Caltech. Alexandra, thank you so much for joining us today.
Hi, everyone. Thank you for tuning in. Now we're in the future. My name is Alex, and I'm going to tell you about quantum simulation with Rydberg atom arrays. So just to start, here's a working definition for quantum simulation. Quantum simulation is the method by which an accessible quantum mechanical system is used to study the properties and dynamics of another quantum mechanical system. The simulated system is typically a large interacting quantum antibody system that can be deterministically initialized, controlled, and measured. And the target system is typically not easily nor fully accessible using other means, such as classical simulation technique or direct experimentation. And indeed, we know that simulating quantum mechanical system is typically hard for classical computer, right? Simulating the dynamics of a large number of interacting particles cannot be done efficiently on a classical computer without stringent approximation. And therefore, the classically accessible quantum dynamics is typically restricted to small system short dynamics and low entanglement regime. And this point was made by Feynman in 1982, and he more or less asked the question, what kind of computers are we going to use to simulate physics? And the answer is we're going to use a computer that uses the fundamental principle of quantum mechanics. So quantum simulation promises to contribute to many different areas of impact, and we've just heard about some of them in quantum chemistry, like simulating electronic structure of correlated electron problems. You might think about computing the ground electronic energy of large molecules and working on problems like nitrogen fixing for fertilizers, industrial catalyzer, and drug discovery. In condensed matter physics, like simulating transport properties of electron or emerging quasiparticle and materials, learning more about the Hubbard models for a better understanding high TC superconductivity, and also studying things like high energy physics and large gauge theory. We're particularly interested in simulating material science, and particularly towards the development of functional materials that might be used in monitoring, diagnosis, and treatment application to increase the well-being of an aging population, as well as materials with exotic properties to store, process, and distribute information and energy more efficiently. You might think here about replacing electrons by spin to eliminate resistive heating in electronic devices, effectively moving away from electronics towards spintronics, or encoding information in topological spin textures, like skirmions, that are robust against perturbation. And this might lead to next generation memories for high performance computing applications. Now, I want to make it clear that underlies this is a promise, and that promise has yet to be realized. Actually, demonstrating a practical quantum advantage remains an open challenge. It hasn't been done yet. And now I'm citing this paper from Microsoft released a few months ago, and more or less assessing the amount of resource that you would need to make a meaningful contribution, achieve a practical quantum advantage. And you see here in the field of quantum chemistry, we need a few months with a few million qubits, and we're not there yet, right? So, usually the approach that is pursued here is using a digital quantum computer. And we know that those quantum computers are a hypothetical device that have yet to be delivered to the world, right? So, and this is not to belittle the opportunity, but rather highlight the challenges. And there's also reason to doubt that we'll be able to achieve exponential speed up in any problem that we set ourselves to solve. So I'm citing here the Garnet Chan at Caltech saying, while quantum computers might still prove useful for quantum chemistry, it may be prudent to assume exponential speed up are not generically available for this problem. And this is great. The community is actively working on those problems, trying to understand, okay, how truly powerful is a quantum computer and how do we get there to achieve a practical quantum advantage. So the typical approach to quantum simulation, or at least what is generally talked about, is using digital quantum computers. And this is done by executing digital quantum circuit form of elementary quantum gate. And they might exploit or not error correction technique to mitigate gate errors. And the protocols are typically platform agnostic algorithm, which lead to large resource overhead. The approach that we're pursuing is analog quantum simulation that, in contrast, execute continuous time control protocol to update parameters of the native models, might exploit noise mitigation technique to improve accuracy, and typically exploit platform-specific features to reduce overhead. And the typical working principle of analog quantum simulator is shown here. It effectively mimics the evolution of an inaccessible quantum system. So here on the left, on the top left, is your inaccessible quantum system, and you'd like to learn about its dynamics and probe its unknown quantum evolution, but you don't have access to it. Therefore, what you're going to do is you're going to map it onto an accessible quantum simulator. You're going to let that simulator evolve under a given control Hamiltonian, and then you're going to map back the observable onto the original system so that you can learn how that system would have evolved. So this is the fundamental principle of analog quantum simulation. The challenges of quantum simulation is finding an efficient mapping between the target and native model. So imagine you wanted to simulate electrons on lattices, finding the mapping or the efficient mapping to the native model, like a spin lattice model, is what is difficult. And that's what we're working on actively in our group on the theory side. So to realize analog quantum simulations, you need a few critical ingredients. On the one hand, you need a collection of small individual quantum system that can encode quantum information in discrete states that are isolated from their environment and that provide a fast accessible mechanism to control and read out the quantum information. On top of that, you need the scalable approach to assemble a large quantum antibody system. In particular, given geometrically local interactions, you need to have the ability to position many such quantum system within interaction range in a small spatial volume, right? To create a lattice of individual quantum system, for example. And finally, you need a strong tunable interaction mechanism to perform entangling operation. And now you have a truly large, controllable, interacting quantum antibody system. And all of those ingredients are provided by our platform. They're called Rydberg atom arrays. I'm going to describe a little bit more details now. So Rydberg atom arrays are analog quantum simulator based on large configuration of individual neutral atoms, individually trapped in large programmable arrays of optical trap that are strongly interacting when excited to high-lying electronic Rydberg state. So just going through that, large configuration of individual neutral atoms, we're working with alkali atoms like rubidium-87, and they offer broad, allowed optical transition for laser cooling and imaging, as well as long-lived hyperfine state to encode quantum information. We can also trap those individual atoms in optical traps. So here's a rendition of our vacuum system where we have a source of rubidium atoms that effectively is being cooled, trapped in magneto-optical trap, and then further trapped in an optical dipole trap. And you can think not just a tightly focused laser beam that capture a single atom here in this little cylinder here. And then the nice thing is we have the ability to take a single laser beam and multiplex it into many such laser beam with arbitrary geometry. And for that purpose, we use active diffractive optical element. And now what you see here on the upper right is optical trap, and each optical trap may or may not capture a single neutral atoms. So now on the bottom right, you see a single shot image of a square lattice of optical trap, and you see either a single neutral atom or not. And then we have further the ability of moving those neutral atoms around to prepare a given configuration. And now finally, to go beyond a collection of non-interacting neutral atoms, you need somewhat to engineer interactions. And we know how to do that efficiently by exciting those neutral atoms to Rydberg state. And you can effectively doing that, for example, in rubidium using a two-current laser beam. And the two atoms excited to Rydberg state interact very strongly. So in the region we're working at, through van der Waal interaction, a very strong interaction, so effectively leading to a strongly interacting quantum antibody system. So now if we were to look at the Hamiltonian, the native model that this quantum simulator realized, is typically transverse field-izing models. So effectively reproducing a collection of spins on the lattices. And this model is interesting, especially if you're doing physics, to simulate quantum phase diagram, non-Euclidean quantum dynamics in various configuration of atoms in up to three dimension with arbitrary geometries, tunable interaction, and single site addressability. This is more or less where the community is at, and there's a further opportunity to realize spin exchange model, effectively, for example, studying transport of spin excitation in 1D chain or two-dimensional spin network. And now you might think about like spin router application where you want to bring one excitation in a 2D spin network from one node to the other, and you'd like to do that efficiently. You might also want to study the transition from ballistic transport to diffusive transport, etc. Something we're very interested in and is addressing this open challenge of finding a mapping to simulate spin orbit coupled material. So those spin orbit coupled materials are interested for condensed matter physicists and material science application as they exhibit exotic quantum phenomena in numerous lattice gas graph structures. And simulating those material would enable, in particular, characterizing the parameter regimes leading to novel quantum critical behavior, exploring various phases of matter, and probing the effect of external perturbation and interaction, as well as investigating quasi-particle dynamics. And the target Hamiltonian that we're considering is this DM interaction here that is known to stabilize skirmion quasi-particles. And these skirmion quasi-particles are topologically protected chiral spin textures that demonstrate high mobility and are therefore a promising candidate for noise mitigation in quantum computing and low energy data storage. So here's a picture of our team, our lab, and somewhat of a description of what we've been working on towards delivering integrated platform for quantum simulation. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Alex. With that, I'd like to welcome all panelists back. If anyone does have any questions, do feel free to post them in the chat. But to get things started, picking off on one of Alex's points there about if we want to do quantum chemistry simulations with digital quantum computers, we're in a very, very distant corner of that plot where it looks like we're going to take some work to do. If we open up the box and allow ourselves to look at things like analog quantum simulators, allow us to use some of those noise mitigation techniques that Ching Lai mentioned, what can we do now? And what do you think that we might be able to do in the not so distant future regarding something with real world applications? Maybe I'll throw it to Professor Kim first.
I think that's a good question. So that the how far, because sometimes it's hard to predict because the field is rapidly growing. And then, so maybe optimistic is even 5 years. Within 5 years, people maybe claim as to solve the real space, the real life problems. And in fact, for example, like optimization problem I mentioned is that those kind of optimization problem would be happening in the even like traffic control. So if you could apply this, the Hamiltonian to describe such that, then even this is already available. Whether we are able to hear it or not, that's a different story. But then there's a lot of efforts to look at this, the drop discovery or the molecular dynamics studies and so on. So this is still very actively ongoing. So I believe this is quite near future, you know, optimistic way.
Ching Lai?
I feel like I'm just going to talk about high energy physics. That's what I'm most familiar with. People have done classical calculations for decades, right? So for quantum people just to come and claim to be able to gain some advantage, I think that is a bit risky. I think what is going to be more realistic is that there is going to be also collaboration between like classical and quantum methods. So before having any kind of quantum advantage, I think it's that is what's more likely to happen. And but in terms of time scale, when that is going to happen, I think that is very, very hard to say because the development of quantum technology is so fast and there are so many possibilities that I think, yeah, it's a very open question.
So, you know, of course, that interaction between the two, that kind of that hybrid structure is going to be incredibly important if we want to get anything out in the near term. Alex?
Yeah, I think my point was that we already have access to programmable quantum simulator hundreds to a thousand atoms with single-sided traceability and tunability. So those system allows already to achieve a near-term quantum advantage, practical quantum advantage that you could quantify and make convincing claim that you could not have achieved similar results using a classical computers, right? On the one hand, in fundamental physics, right, simulating ground phase diagrams of 2D spin models in the large scales. And those results are already important, not only in advancing our understanding of fundamental physics, but also benchmarking classical simulation tools. Now, in terms of making a practical commercial application that benefits society, we believe, and that's our working assumption, that it will happen first in material science. And there, the challenge is finding the mapping, right? So now we have access to those spin lattice models. Can we find an efficient mapping to simulate fermions on lattices or to simulate spin orbit coupled materials? And now if we can find that, then we can in turn better understand how to design novel material, how to fabricate them, inform on where we're expected to find interesting properties. And then it will accelerate the technological development cycles.
Mm-hmm. All right. So actually, talking about that mapping, that seems to be one of the common things that come up is how do we take something that we want to learn about and map it onto something that we can control? And this is, I imagine, where many of the experimental and theoretical groups intersect with each other. So starting with Jing Lai on this one, because I know you mentioned working with different experimental groups, how do experimental and theoretical groups work together? How do these collaborations tend to come up? And I guess broadly, why do we need those groups to talk to each other?
So we really need these groups to talk to each other because I feel every specific field has very specific needs. So for us, we might have we might need quantum hardware. Quantum hardware needs that are completely different from what people need, for example, for quantum chemistry or other fields. And as a theoretician, for me, it's extremely important to really talk to the experimentalist and get to learn what are the limitations and advantages of each system, because that is especially in the near term, those limitations are going to be very important in determining which system is going to be the most successful in simulating the models that we're interested in.
All right. Alex, from the other side, how do you work with other groups?
I think there's a challenge in somewhat bridging capability of experimentalists with problem application, right? So how experimentalists can efficiently work with condensed matter physicists. And this bridge is usually provided by theorists, and theorists come in different flavors. So we have those that perform hardcore simulations at the cutting edge, or maybe coming up more on the analytic side, are coming up with clever intuition or heuristic. Often the approach is just getting together and establishing a language so that everybody understand each other, and making sure that the problem is properly defined such that the opportunity exists and is near-term achievable. But definitely as the community grows and the connections are being made, the progress will accelerate.
And Professor Kim.
Yeah, I agree all of the comments by two speakers. And I just pointed out one thing is that the often when we observe certain problems, we can't solve like all the details. We'd like to have some gist of the problems. So that's the kind of the expression of, you know, in the physics term is a Hamiltonian. So that by looking at such the crucial Hamiltonian to describe the properties of the material or the high energy physics and so on, then we already gain a lot of things. So I think that's the typical, the modeling of theorists do, so that when they observe this phenomena, how to explain, so that's a form of the Hamiltonian or form of the expression. And then the experimentalists want to realize or implement that the mathematical language into the concrete platform. So in that way, it's not isolated, it has to be integrated together.
Perfect. So one question, I'll start with Alex on this one. So we often try to group ourselves into buckets a bit where it's, you know, this is quantum computing, this is quantum communication, this is quantum sensing. Of course, research does bleed into other fields as well. So how do the ideas and technologies that you work on in your group overlap with some of the other areas of quantum information science?
Yeah, so Rydberg atoms, there can be used as sensors, and those sensors are currently being used to develop next generation antennas, for example. The same arrays of neutral atoms can be used to build optical clocks, and these can be used in quantum metrology to better measure time, perform measurement in geodesy or oil and mining exploration. In terms of quantum communication, there's a real opportunity there. So atoms, you know, they like laser light, and we know there's still the challenge of bringing those photons out and connecting with, let's say, superconducting microwave qubits. So here we need optical to microwave conversions. You would need efficient emission in the bandwidth that is compatible with the communication infrastructure. And this is an active field of research. So it's likely that the next generation quantum networking structure will involve atoms in a level, or at least at some level.
Mm-hmm. Awesome. Professor Kim, any ways that the research you're working on overlaps with some of the other fields of quantum information science?
I absolutely agree with you that but then like we can also consider two ways. One is a visible or direct way, or the other is invisible, like indirect way. So visible way is that, for example, if we develop some of the new materials or they develop the new technology like single photon detectors and so on, and obviously it's used for this the quantum computation, and also the Rydberg, the sensor is the using as a metrology and so on. Indirect way is that we can also provide the understanding of this the quantum technology and system so that the impact would be even like kind of much broad and wide, so that they not always the observable things, but then we can also have the hidden like kind of profound the foundation, so that I think we can also reach this both ways.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, some of the ways that we develop these things aren't necessarily apparent when we're actually doing them until much later. Jinglai, what about your group?
In the field of classical lattice computations, people at the time were doing calculations with the rudimentary computers. They were really pushing the frontier of the technology. And talking with people in that field, that really provided a scientific motivation and a push for the development of classical computer. And I like to think that our field also provides this kind of motivation for in a corresponding way for quantum technologies. We have these big scientific questions that are there and are interesting for the community, and I like to think that we provide a meaningful motivation for the development of quantum technologies, and that's why we like to collaborate with experimentalists, right? Because we really want to learn what we can do, and we want to really push the boundaries.
Excellent. All right, we do have one question in the chat, actually from a graduate of the USQIP program, directed at Professor Kim, asking, how are you dealing with reconfigurability in your system? How are you tuning the interactions at each site? Essentially, what are your knobs, I guess, for controlling your Hamiltonian?
Thanks for the question, because again, like we are building up the semiconductor so that there's a lot of different knobs. One knob is even overlapping with the Alex system, like kind of using the spatial light modulator so that we could also design the laser profiles. We can also do this programmable way to make the device in a nanofabrication techniques. And we can also combine some other electrodes, the electric fields and magnetic fields, so that we could do that. One way right now we are doing is that we are making the lattice in a different dimensions, so that we can also reconfigure the lattice sites, so that because of the change of the lattice sites took form affect the other energy terms. So that's the one way we can do that.
Awesome. All right. So next question, I'll start by directing to Jinglai. So we talked a bit about how digital quantum computers differentiate from quantum simulators. What challenges are unique to designing quantum simulators, and what opportunities do you think are unique?
I think there is a double-edged sword. So I guess my opinion, the main opportunity is that we have lower requirement than having a full torrent digital computer, right? Because we just need our quantum simulator to imitate a specific system. So in that sense, we might consider it a special purpose quantum computer instead of a universal quantum computer. But on the other hand, we have this difficulty that Alexandra also mentioned, where given the system that we want to study, we really need to find a controllable quantum systems that matches well, and where the mapping can be natural, and where so that it is easier to perform the simulation, right? So I feel like there are advantages and disadvantages.
Alexandre?
I thought it was a great answer. And I thought maybe a challenge is there's no compiler in quantum simulation, right? Like you know what you have, you know what you want, and now you need to be very clever. And I would like to somewhat have computer being clever for us and coming up with heuristic and models and working out the theory, especially at scale, is usually difficult. So this is one of the challenge. But indeed, opportunities, we're dealing with noisy system, and all of the tools we develop can also be used for quantum computing applications. So the advantage here is there's near-term opportunity in terms of realizing a practical quantum advantage in fostering our understanding of fundamental physics, and also in potentially impacting technological developments.
Mm-hmm. And Professor Kim?
My assessment of the state of the quantum simulator at the moment is that as Alex mentioned, that the 1,000 qubits of the quantum simulator to mimic or the certain problems, but these problems are already well known. So that in other words, the quantum simulators can solve the known problems well. So that's the given part. However, one critical problem is that we are not dealing with the single qubit addressable problems. In other words, there's a no concept of error correction. Therefore, if you are solving the unknown problem or the new problems, then there's no guarantee that what you find is the answer or the answer. So therefore, in this case, the best the approach we can do is that the given Hamiltonian, let's build it like my system solid state, and Alex builds is the Ripper, and then somebody builds the superconducting, and we compare and then see whether the answers are converging. Although this effort does not guarantee that we are reaching the answer or the answer, but then this is the way to overcome the critical issues about the quantum simulator.
Yeah, we need to approach it from many different areas. So one more question, particularly related to how we build these experiments for, I do want to share one of Kieran's questions. That's kind of the last question for the panel. But we saw some pictures of some of the lab results. What infrastructure and facilities are needed to actually make these experiments happen? So I'll start with Alex on this one.
And we tend to believe the challenge is the equipment. The challenge is building the team, right? Requires a lot of expertise and many years of hard work. And this is where the true challenge relies, right? It's putting in the work over many years and keeping confident that results will come out. In terms of infrastructures, most of it can be bought from the internet. Luckily, laser technology has been quite mature, but really to push the technology, there's a need to we're currently limited by what's available on the market. So now in terms of what is needed is ultra high vacuum equipment, high power, low noise lasers. You need to bring all of that together. So there's a lot of work to be done on the software and integration side. And then obviously low noise electronics, et cetera. So the challenge is really system integration more than the virus equipment, putting all the different things together and building a large system that seamlessly work very well with one another.
Mm-hmm. Professor Kim, what about for your lab? What research infrastructure and facilities are key for making your research happen?
Right, as Alex mentioned, we are towards to building the system level, which is the interdisciplinary work, meaning that we require this electronics, the mechanical aspects and chemical, physical, and all of these things. In addition, in our cases, we are using the semiconductors so that the nanofabrication is essential to create, so that the luckily the University of Waterloo has the beautiful the nanofabrication infrastructure, which is the very essential for us.
Before we go to that one final question, because I do want to come back to that developing a team point that Alex brought up, we did have one question come up in the chat regarding a point you brought up about a compiler. So do we see any kind of sometime in the near term future, do we see a toolbox being developed for people who are not in the lab, not intimately familiar with the equipment to start using these kind of devices? Perhaps Zhengli, I'll throw that one to you first.
So there are toolkits right now available online that the people can use. And from the point of view of a theoretician using this, these tools to do research, I would say that what we need a bit more of is the development of kits that are on one hand, easy to use and easy to learn, of course, that's a bonus. But then on the other hand, we sometimes have a difficulty where we don't have as much access as we wish we had to. Because when we do, when we solve these research problems, sometimes we have to really push what this toolbox can do. And that is not always always so easy. So I find from theoretical research point of view, we need a bit more access and a bit more transparency. In what's happening on the experimental side when we try to use this.
Yeah, if we want to use it for research problems, we better be able to understand what's going on under the hood effectively.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah. Alex, anything to add there?
Yeah, there are many commercial entities that are now bringing programmable quantum simulator on the cloud, and they come up with API. So our mission is also to deliver an access to quantum simulator, in particular to the Canadian research community. But our model is slightly different. So as opposed to coming up with a toolbox and an API and people use it remotely, we want to engage with users and we want to engage with those that have problems. And it seems that the greatest near-term opportunity will exist when experimentalists and theorists sit down together, right? Or together or through virtual sitting down. And then they discuss saying, okay, what can we do? And then there's a discussion, because what we can do in the lab, especially in an academic setting, evolve based on needs, right? It's a continuously evolving system, and this is where we believe the real opportunity exists.
Excellent. Professor Kim?
Yeah, I also, on the positive side, so that the near future, probably there's going to be the start of companies, so that it's a full of the theorists who can maybe talk to this the different experimentals, and then they even consider the agnostic compiler, so that certain Hamiltonian would be translated in the different platforms. And obviously in that case, as Alex emphasizes, that the theorist has to understand what's happening in the experiment, so that the conversation is really important.
Mm-hmm. Excellent. All right, so we have just a couple minutes left, so I did want to ask one final question. There was a few comments in the chat early on from people who are in their undergraduate studying and looking at ways to get involved. So when you're building up your teams, what research skills are you looking for? What skills do you recommend students interested in your field start to develop? Alex, I'll throw this one to you first.
Yeah, so when recruiting undergrad, and we've been very successful at onboarding and mentoring undergraduate students. And what I typically look for is applied math and programming skills, because those are the skills that can be developed at this level. And the developing an advanced understanding of quantum mechanics usually come later. The second thing I think is really important to get hands-on experience, right? Either in a lab environment, but not necessarily, just getting involved in project, learning how to identify problem, formulating solution, and delivering on those solution. And if this can be done as part of a team, meaning like great critical thinking skills, analytical skills, communication skills, and team working skills, then these makes a really strong candidate. So in general, I encourage students, especially when they're young, okay, get engaged in an exciting project and just read the textbook and do the hard work, because it just becomes increasingly difficult afterwards to get the basis solids, and it's the time to just get really strong in math, programming, and obviously also physics.
Awesome. Naya?
I just echo all of what Alex said, but I emphasize two things, meaning like the technical intelligence is obviously it's necessary. So I don't have to enumerate, but then I like to emphasize the critical thinking, as the Alex pointed out, and also the great persistence, because the research problem is not just solving this textbook, the well-defined problem. So that it's 99% fail in the lab, you have to overcome the barriers. So that if you don't have such kind of grit or persistence to overcome that challenges, then often it's a very hard time, but it's fun. So that's why it's a team building with those passionate persistence is a plus.
Awesome. Jiang Lai, to you at last.
Yeah, I agree. I think those were all excellent answers. I just want to put the focus on one, getting research experience as early as possible. Because, as Professor Kim said, it's very different from solving problems for one given set from a course. So you really need to challenge yourself and find and figure out as soon as possible if that is right for you and if you have the right attitude. And another thing I would like to focus is, if possible, do these research projects in a collaboration because I feel like it's absolutely necessary, like in the quantum research world now, it's very rare to have a solitary genius solving everything. We really have to learn from the expertise of other people and learn how to communicate with other people and to exchange the expertise and really push the research forward.
Fantastic. With that, we have reached the end of our panel. Professor Kim, Dr. Cooper Roy, Dr. Zhang, thank you so much for joining us today. I had a wonderful time. I hope you did as well. As a reminder to those of you watching, please do check out the Undergraduate School on Experimental Quantum Information Processing. There is 1 month left to apply. If you're in your third or fourth year of undergraduate and looking to build that research experience, this is a great opportunity to do so. And be sure to follow our channel to learn about upcoming live streams in the new year. I hope everyone has a wonderful holiday break, and thank you so much for joining again. Have a good night, everyone.